I'm amazed because I believe that God deposits such wealth in this house, and we should always look around at the blessings that are all around us, you know? When I always look at you, Pastor Edward, I wonder why sometimes God would take you from across the world and bring you over here. And I find it no small or simple thing that you sit here with us, you know? Amen. And, that's all right. Brother Bob, I know you're getting ready to go back to New York, but, you know, I feel honored that you come here. You know, I'm honored that you I know you're here and you're vacationing, you're with the children and the grandchildren, but you're here on a Sunday. So we pray God be with you as you drive back, and God keep you and your family safe. God bless your family and bless you and bring you back to us again. Okay, thank you, brother. I want us to keep our brother Jack and our sister Linda up in prayer. Our sister Linda, she did lose her brother last night. Her brother went home to be with the Lord. So that you come here on a Sunday morning to be with the family, we give you our prayers, our love, and our support. And even as you prepare to go to California to be with your family, Linda, we're with you. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And every one of you, that's all right. Everyone. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. You know, we were talking on Wednesday night. The series that we're in is experiencing the heart of Jesus. Experiencing the heart of Jesus. And you know, the heart of Jesus, that what made him so powerful, or more powerful than any of his contemporaries, was his love. That's what made him so powerful. That's what made him stand out. That's what made the crowds follow him wherever he went, because of his love, his compassion. He took note of folks that perhaps no one would take note of. He took note of a tax collector. He took note of a wee little man that had to go on a tree to see him. He was so small. He took note of a woman that was in the midst of a multitude that reached out to touch the hem of his garment. And he had the whole world stop to say, take note of this woman of faith. You know, it was his compassion. He sees you in the midst of the crowd. He points you out when you think that you're hidden or not seen or not heard or not important or not significant. He sees you. He sees you. And that's what made Jesus so powerful. And that's what will make us so powerful. Amen?
Amen.
See the people. See their hearts, you know, and then touch them wherever they are in life. We talked on Wednesday about Jesus Christ. He was giving us the freedom. He was setting us free from hopelessness. And the picture that we painted on Wednesday was that of us being in a wilderness or a jungle at times, or if we were in a wilderness or a jungle, and we got lost, and it would seem as if we would have no hope if we were lost in a jungle where we couldn't find the path, where we couldn't see the light of day, and if we were surrounded by wild beasts all around us. And I said it was as if our Pastor Edward would take us to his homeland in Africa, and he was going to bring us on a safari, and we're all following Pastor Edward. And if we're in Africa, I don't know, has anyone been in Africa besides our Pastor Edward? Anyone? Okay, we're all going, brother. We are all going. So if we're in his backyard, we're going to the jungle. You and I have no idea where we are, where we're going, but he's in front of us leading the way. And, you know, as he said on Wednesday, he has his machete in his hand, and he's whacking out all the weeds, and he's creating a path, and we're following him to paradise, to his hometown. You and I would say, Pastor Edward, do you know where you're going? Do you know where we are? And we said on Wednesday, where is the path? Where's the path that we will walk on? And Pastor Edward would turn around to each and every one of us, and with confidence in his voice and strength in his eyes, he would say, I am the path. I am the path. And therefore, don't look to the ground and don't look for your own confidence. He says, just hold on to me, and I'll get you to where you need to be. And we said, that's a picture of Jesus in John, where Jesus says, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. And so when you are in your life and you can't see your path and you can't see the light of day, and it seems like there's wild beasts all around you, and you say, Lord, I don't know where I'm going, I don't know what I'm doing, he says, you're not supposed to. He says, just hold on to me, I'm your path. Just don't let go of me. Just keep your eyes on me, and you'll never be lost in this life. Amen. 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 Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So if you have your Bibles, why don't you turn there to John chapter 14. in regard to that passage. Because the title of our conversation today is just that. When Jesus turned to his disciples and he said, I am the way. You know the rest?
The truth.
I am the truth. And I am the life. Praise the Lord. John chapter 14, let's read a few verses there, maybe 1 through 6. Jesus starts off, he knows he's about to go to Calvary and that his disciples will be brought into confusion only for a short time, but he tries to comfort them before he goes to the cross, and he says to his disciples, he says, do not let your heart be troubled. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God? Yes. Jesus says, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And where I go, you know. Jesus said to his disciples, where I'm going, you know. And Jesus says to his disciples, and the way, you know. He says, you know, you know. And then a bold disciple lifted up his voice. His name was Thomas. And Thomas said, no, we don't know. He said, oh, we do not know where you're going. And how can we know the way? If we don't know where you're going, how can we know the way? And that's where Jesus said, Jesus said unto him, he said, I am the way. He said, I am the truth. And I am the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. Amen.
Amen.
Word of the Lord. Word of the Lord. I thank God that we have a compassionate Lord, that before he even speaks to us truths or deep truths, the first thing he says to us is, he says, don't let your heart be troubled. Now don't be alarmed and don't get anxious, okay? Don't you worry. He said, you believe in God. He says, believe also in me. You know, the truth of the matter is, you make that bold question or that general question to the masses. You could ask that question across the globe. You could say, do you believe in God? I think whatever or whomever they call God, I believe most people in this world will say, yes, I believe in God. And he said, you believe in God? He didn't even ask him the question. He told him. He wasn't asking. He said, you believe in God. That's what he said. You believe in God. But then he said, now believe also in me. And what he was illustrating from that point forward is the relationship between him and his father. He said, I'm going to my father's house, right? I'm going to my father's house, that where I am, you may be also. He wants to bring you also to the father's house. You see, the question isn't whether you believe in God or not, because almost the whole world believes in God. It's just that we don't believe our relationship with God. We think that our God is outside of us sometimes. We believe our God is far away from us. Sometimes. Anybody? We believe that our God is not happy with us sometimes. We believe at times that our God might be angry with us, and if not with us, I know he's angry with you. If he ain't angry with me, I know he's angry at someone. Someone's going to hell. And he said, the question isn't whether you believe in God. You believe in God. He said, you just don't believe who you are and who your God is. You don't know that God is your father. That's what you don't know. Because if you knew that God was your father and you were his child, you would have no fear. You would have no trouble. Amen?
Amen.
You would know that you have a place in the Father's house. Your God is not outside of you or far away from you or not angry with you. Your Father, man, your Father lives with you. He says, you are one with the Father, and the Father is one with you. And we know that in a natural way that physically you are part of your parents. Physically. Your parents are in you and you are in your parents. Just physically, that's true. And Jesus is saying this is true of you. God is part of you. God is part of you. He's not just in your heart. He's part of who you are. He's part of your blood and your cells and your DNA. And that's why Jesus said in the Psalms, the psalmist declared, he says, but you are God's. He said, you are God's. Why? Because God is your father. How can God be your father and you not be God's? Of course you are. Like Zeus himself, who had children, and his children were gods. A God produces God. It's just that simple. For you to say that God is not a part of who you are is to deny who God is. Or to deny that he is your father. To deny that he is your father. And that's why Jesus says, let me tell you something. God is your father. Amen? And he said, I'm going to the Father's house. Because he says, there's lots of room. I'm going to make a room for you in my Father's house. And you see, so often we believe in God, but we believe that God is just so separated from us. And that's what Jesus came to save us all from. He came to save us from separation from God. So many times, I know I do, therefore I believe you do as well. We can go through days not even having a thought of God, just getting through the daily things of life, right? Whether it be family or work or situations or circumstances, as if God isn't even part of the equation of our life. As if we're just getting through life and we believe in God, but he's nowhere near us. And that's why God says, no, you don't really know who your father is. You don't even know that God is your father. And sometimes as we acquire this pursuit to follow God, we think that our life is about doing something for him or discovering him. I want to say that our life is not about what we are doing for him. We think our life, and I do, and I think you do too, even just this morning, I think that my life is about what am I doing for God? Like, God, what do you want me to do today? Has anyone ever thought that or said that?
Yes.
But God, what do you want me to do today? Like, I got to do something for God. I'm a Christian. I'm supposed to do something for God. Right? Yeah. So what am I doing for you? And then we think it's our responsibility, our duty, because I love God. Lord, I want to do the right thing today. I know some of you don't care, but I want to do something like that. But some of us care. And we say, I want to praise you. What am I supposed to do today? And I know God speaks to me, and he speaks to you as he speaks to me. He says, Michael, he says, it's not about what you are doing for me. Life isn't about what you do for God. Life is about what he is doing through you. God wants to say, I just want to wake you up about what I'm doing in you. Your whole life is about what God is doing in your life. It's just the opposite. It's just the opposite. You don't have to study to follow him in that way. You don't have to study to please him. You don't have to study and work hard to do the right thing. All you have to do is wake up to the fact that he's already doing it for you. And when I hear that truth, that my life is not about what I do in him, my life is about what he is doing in me, all of a sudden, I used a good word the other day, Debbie, it's discovery. All it is awareness. It's discovery of what God is already doing in your life. He's already doing it. You think it was your will to get up and come to church this morning? Well, yeah, two to one, so that's a correct answer, yes. But it was the Father's will. It's what God did in you, Robin. God woke you up and miraculously got you here this morning. Every one of you is just as much of a miracle that you're here. You want to give me a witness? Yeah. It's not what you did for God this morning. It's what God did in you today. God woke me up. He gave me the strength to get ready, the desire to be here. And I say, God, thank you for bringing me here today. Amen. And that's why Jesus said to his disciples, I know you believe in God, but it's more than that. It's you and the Father being one. It's not what you're doing for him. It's what he's already doing in you and in the world. He's already doing it. It's his plan. It's his world. He's very happy with it all. So, but when Jesus says, I go, let's see, verse 14, he says, let not your heart be troubled. He said, in my Father's house there are many mansions. He talks about his Father's house. So the question might be, well, where is the Father's house, or what is the Father's house? And we might say, well, the Father's house is heaven. That's a correct answer. But when, I'll listen to this now. But when any time we take all these things and put it outside of us, it's going back to the same beginning, that you know God, but you don't really know Jesus. Because anytime you think that all these things are outside of you, we are the ones who know God but don't really know that we are part of Him. So when we say think of the Father's house, if I think the Father's house is heaven out there, all of a sudden, in a moment, I have disassociated myself with the Father's house. Because if heaven is out there somewhere, I'm not in the Father's house. And if I'm not in the Father's house, my life has got everything I can do to get into the Father's house. And then with that thinking, I might be so ignorant as to say some of you ain't going to make it to the Father's house. Because I don't know Jesus. I know God, but that doesn't help me. He says, you know God, but you don't know me. You believe in God, but you don't believe in me. He said, my Father's house, he says, I'm going to my Father's house. And all of a sudden, the disciples said, where are you going, man? Where are you going? And they said, we don't know the way. You ever experienced stuff like that, where someone's trying to teach you the ways of God, and you believe God is talking to you, and you're in a state of panic and confusion, and you're like, well, I don't know what to do. I don't know where I'm going. I have no idea. You got one or two honest nods. And that's how we are in our panic. And God is in panic. He says, you know the way. It's impossible for you not to know the way. He says, I'm in you. You just don't know you know the way. Because you think everything is outside. Everything is just beyond you. I have to get it, acquire it. How am I going to get to the Father's house? What do I have to do to get to the Father's house? And Jesus is about to reveal the mystery of the Father's house. The mystery of the Father's house. And I think the mystery of the Father's house is this. The Father's house is you. You are the Father's house. Because God said from the beginning of time, I don't want to dwell in a building made with bricks and stones, maybe even marble and gold. He says, I got no desire to live in those kind of buildings. He says, I want to live among my people. I want to live inside of you. Guess what, everybody? You are the Father's house. Is there a witness in the house?
Yeah.
He said, I'm going to my Father's house. He says, you are the Father's house. So immediately what we're doing is we're taking away the God that's out there in the house of the Father that's out there and saying, no, you don't even know who you are. You are the Son of the Father. You are the Father's house. Man, God is closer to you. When Jesus Christ walked the earth, he said, the kingdom of heaven, man. He said, the kingdom of heaven's among you. It's near you. It's closer than your hands and feet. It's inside of you, he said.
Amen.
Where is the Father's house? You are the Father's house. You are the Father's house. God dwells in you. Does anybody believe that God dwells in you? Yeah. He said, I'm going to my Father's house. Think about that. Think about that. Okay, now I'm not thinking about that. Now next time. Okay, so I'm going to my Father's house. And you know, there's plenty of passages in the Bible, you know, in Revelation, I won't turn there, but at the end of it, even when God told Moses, he says, make me a tabernacle. Remember when God told Moses, the first time the house of God was ever built upon the earth, it was the tabernacle of Moses. And even as he built it, it's like, that was the pattern of the true tabernacle, remember? He said to Moses, make the tabernacle according to specs, and if you make it according to specs, I will come and dwell and live among you. And the fulfillment of that is found in Revelation when John finally, at the end of it all, he sees the new heaven and he sees the new earth. He sees Jerusalem coming out of heaven and it says, Jerusalem is the bride. You are Jerusalem. And then the Lord declares, I have come to dwell with my people, to live among my people. He said, all along you were my house. All along you were my house. When David was preparing to build the temple, the great temple of Solomon, and as Solomon dedicated that temple, even Solomon himself, after the temple was being dedicated, he said, Solomon said in his prayer, he said, the heavens cannot contain you, God. The earth cannot contain you. How less can this building contain you? And God is in all of you. He's in all of you. And you are the house of the Father. And then Paul, later on in his epistles, he would say something simple like this, and I think he said it simple so we would all remember it. He said, know ye not, do you not know that you are the temple of God? Has anyone heard that passage before in Corinthians?
Yes.
Do you not know that you are the temple of God? So when Jesus said, I'm going to my Father's house, you are the Father's house. But he was going to the Father's house to make room for you. To make room for you. To give you an awareness that your life is not outside of you. Your life is inside of you. You live from the inside of you, not from the outside of you. Your abode is on the inside of you, not the outside of you. Now that might not make sense to you. But you see, your life is never outside of you. It's about what I'm going to get tomorrow. What's outside of my grasp? I'm trying to please God, and I want to get into the house of the Father. And I want on that day just to hear the words of God say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. And I think everyone has thought that thought at one time. We think that God is outside of us. Life is outside of us. Goodness is outside of us. If I can only get a hold of it, if I can only get a hold of it. And he said, listen, man, I'm going to the Father's house, and I'm going to make a room for you so that you can be where I am. You can realize your life is inside of you. It's not outside of you. Your heaven is inside of you, not outside of you. Your God is inside of you, not outside of you. Your joy is inside of you, not outside of you. Because you are the Father's house. And even Lamentations, one of the books of the Bible, it says that eternity is in the hearts of men. Man, eternity is in your heart. Jesus said, I'm going to my Father's house. And I'm going to prepare a place for you. That where I am, there you may be also. And Thomas said, but I don't know the way. You say, I know the way, but I don't know the way. And the way was inside of him. That's why Jesus says, you know the way. Heaven was inside of him. And he says, I don't know where heaven is. He's like, Thomas. I don't know where happiness is, some of you might say. I don't know where my joy is. I don't know where my health is. I don't know where my compassion is. I don't know. I don't know where it is. Where is my prosperity? I don't know. Jesus, you say I have it, but we say back to Jesus, but I ain't got it. I don't have joy, Jesus. I don't have peace. No. I don't have riches, Jesus. And he says, you have it. He says, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. He says, I'm going to my Father's house. I'm going to my Father's house. I'm going to prepare a place for you. And then I'm going to come back and get you and bring you to where I am so that you may live in the Father's house with me and you may realize that all these riches dwell inside you. Because when Jesus walked the earth, he knew he missed nothing. He knew that the fullness of the Godhead dwelled inside of him bodily. Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to prepare a place for you. And then he's going to come back and take you to where he is. And you're going to start living from the inside of you, not from the outside of you. In my Father's house, there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. Amen to that. So Jesus goes to the cross. And the picture of Jesus going to the cross was this. Jesus had to get to the other side. He had to get to the other side of life, the other side of this flesh. You know, sometimes we think it's this flesh that separates us from God. It's the visible realm that separates us from the invisible realm. So Jesus wanted to get to the other side. He had to get to the invisible world so that he can bring you to the invisible world with him. And the only way to get to the invisible world was to break his body and get out of that body and get into the invisible world. Well, let me at least give you a picture of that. Give you a picture of that. Jesus had to get to the other side. He had to get to the other side. He had to get to the other side of death. He had to get to the other side of sorrow. He had to get to the other side. And I think it's like the crossing over we talked about before, friend. You know, sometimes we're living in depression and anxieties and fears and confusion and you name it. But we just got to get to the other side of that. What's the other side of depression? Joy. Did you forget that one? What's the other side of infirmity? Health. What's the other side of weakness? Come on, help me out, brother. Strength. What's the other side of death? Life. It's got to get you to the other side, that's all. Will anybody admit they need to go to the other side? He says, I want to get you to the other side. He said, I'll go first, then I'll come back and get you. So he went to the cross, right? He went to the cross. So on that cross, as Jesus hung upon that cross, we approach our Easter Sunday. If you have your Bibles, you want to turn. We go to Matthew chapter 27, verse 51, when Jesus is on the cross. Because he said, I'm going to the Father's house, and this is how he gets to the Father's house. He had to go to the cross to get to the Father's house. He was going to go there and he'd come back and get you and bring you there with him. Matthew 27. Maybe verse 51. When Jesus hung upon the cross, Scripture says in 51, and behold, the veil of the temple, who is the temple, by the way? Know ye not? You are the temple, right? Okay. So it says, and behold, the veil of the temple was torn. It was torn in two from the top to the bottom. And the earth quaked, and the rocks were split, and the graves. Now we're supposed to stop there for a second. It says, behold, the veil of the temple ripped. You guys know when Jesus was on the cross, even before he was on the cross. Remember the beating? You guys didn't see the movies, The Passion, or I think everybody was hungry to see the picture of the crucifixion. And even the beating that he took before the crucifixion. And Scripture tells us that when the body of Jesus, when his flesh was torn, it was a picture of the veil of the temple being torn, because all the glory was inside. You had to rip the veil to get into the glory. So as the flesh of Jesus was whipped before he went to the cross, and even as he went upon the cross and they continued to tear his flesh, it was a symbol of the veil of the temple that was being torn. Because once the veil of the temple was torn, you would now have access into the Father's house. But it says at the same time that the flesh of Jesus was torn, at the same time that he hung upon the cross, he said at the same time, he said the veil of the temple was also torn at the same time. At the same time his body was broken, your body was broken. Because know you're not that you are the temple. So at the same time his body was broken, your body was broken. Remember why he's doing this. He's doing this so we can go to the Father's house, make a room for you, go and get you and bring you back with him. So his body had to be torn and your body was torn at the same time. Your flesh. And it says that the veil of the temple was torn from the top to the bottom. That means Jesus is going to get into your life from the way you think to the way you live. Jesus Christ is going to get into your life from the way you think. He's going to tear your flesh, your carnal, natural way of thinking, to the way you think and to the way you live. He's going to tear it from the top to the bottom. At the same time as he hung upon the cross, as his body was torn, your body was torn. For what purpose? So that he can have access into the Father's house. He was going to go into the Father's house, which was you, and then bring you back there with him. Let me say, I'm going to turn to another passage with you of the account. Why don't you turn with me to, stay there. I'm going to read the next two verses with you. In 52, it says this. In 52, it says, and the graves were open, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. And then with that, I want to turn to Luke 23. I'll expound in a second. In Luke 23, verses 45 to 46. It says, when Jesus hung upon the cross, it says, and it was about the sixth hour, and there was darkness over the earth until the ninth hour. Then the sun was darkened, and it says the veil of the temple was torn in two. And when Jesus had cried out with a loud voice, he said, what did he say? He said, my Father, he said, Father, Father, into your hands commend or commit my spirit. And having said this, it says he breathed his last, or some translation says he gave up the ghost. He gave up the ghost. He gave up the ghost. As he hung upon the cross and the veil of his temple was broken, it says that his spirit went out of him. His spirit went out of him because he gave up the ghost. Can I get a witness? It says his spirit went out of him. He gave up the ghost. Where did his spirit go? He said, Father, into your hands do I commit my spirit. And I say to you, you are the hands and the feet of God. Has anyone read scriptures like how beautiful upon the mountain are the feet of them that bring good news? Do you know that you are the hands and the feet of God? All throughout the New Testament church, the apostles would take their hands and lay their hands upon the folks' heads. Why would they do that? They would take their precious hands and they would put their hands upon the people and they would anoint them with oil and they would pray for them. And Jesus said to all his disciples, he says, go, anoint the sick, go, touch them and cleanse the lepers. Why? You think my hands can heal anybody? No. No. No, no. Because now we were the hands of God. We were the feet of God. When Jesus walked the earth, he was the hands and feet of God. He said, I'm going, and now you're taking my place. He said, now you're the hands and you're the feet of God. So when he said, into thy hands do I commit my spirit, where do you think his spirit went? Inside of you, went to the Father's house. And that's why the temple, the veil was rent. At the same time his temple was rent, the veil of the temple was rent, because the spirit was going inside of you. The spirit was going inside of you. He said, I'm going to my Father's house. We said earlier, where's the Father's house? You are the Father's house. Not out there somewhere. So you believe in God. He said, believe in me. I'm in you, man. Where do you think the spirit went and left the atmosphere? He said, Father, into your hands. To your hands. And that's why our temple, our veil was rent from the way we think about things to the way we live our lives. He says, I'm going to enter into the true holy of holies. He says, Father, into your hands do I commit my spirit. He went to the Father's house. He went into you, into me, into all of the world. He woke something up inside of you. That's why Thomas said, I don't know where you're going. He said, Thomas, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He said, you know the way. I'm inside of you, man. God always said, I'm here. I'm with you. I'm among you. The kingdom was never outside of you going someplace. Even the disciples in the beginning, they never said, when are we going to the kingdom? They always said, Father, when are you bringing the kingdom to us? The kingdom is always in you and among you. And that's why this passage, it continues to say in Matthew it says the rocks were split. It said the earth quaked. It said the graves were opened. Do you remember the account? Do you remember the account when Jesus hung upon the cross? It said the graves were opened. And you know what happened when Jesus was on the cross? It says, and the bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. So back in the day, I guess people that were in their graves got up and started walking around. Man, that's crazy. That is freaky, man. Freaky. But I believe the true story is a spiritual story where it says, hey, hey, hey. He said he went to your grave. He went to your heart. And he woke something up inside of you. He woke up the Christ inside of you. Well, you say, God's not in me. He's out there. He said he went to the Father's house. He woke you up. He said, hello, anybody at home? He said, I come to wake up the dead. And he woke you up, he rose you from your sleep, he rose you from your resting place, he rose you from the place that said, I don't have faith, I don't have hope, I don't have love, I don't have the kingdom. And he went and he split it wide open. And he raised the dead. And he said, come forth now and walk and live in this life, for I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. When Jesus went to Lazarus and Jesus said to Mary and Martha, he said that your brother will live. And Martha said, well, Mary said, I know he will live in that day. Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. We always put God outside of us. He says, I'm in you. He said, my life, although he lays in the grave, is in him. And he said, I'll prove it to you. Called his name and said, Lazarus. We are in these bodies, caught behind this veil of flesh, thinking that if we could only break this veil of flesh, we'll be with the Father. And Jesus says, no, I go before you to prepare a place for you, that where I am, there you may be also. Not someday, by and by. It's instantaneous with Jesus Christ. He says, no, I'm going inside of you to the Father's house, that where I am, you may. Now you're going to start living from the inside out. You're going to live from the kingdom of God that's in you. You and the Father are going to be one, as a matter of fact. You live with the Father in his house. Does anybody know that you are the temple of the living God? Does anybody know that? Oh, we say that, but we don't understand that. We have no idea what that means. We live these lives as if we're just human, and we have a complaining and crying about how bad life is, and because we don't know that we are the sons and children of God. We have no idea. We have no idea. And that's why we all want to die sometimes and go to heaven, because you don't know heaven's inside of you. Where do you think you're going to go when you leave these physical bodies out there? You ain't going out there. I'm sorry, there ain't no out there. Scripture says that we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witness that I tell you what, those who have gone before us, we are surrounded, folks. We're surrounded. They're around you and they're in you. Because if Jesus is in you, then everyone else is in you. Why? Because you are the Father's house. He says, I go to prepare a place for you. You walk in ignorance. You don't even know who you are and who I am. He says, but I'm going to go before you. He says, I'm going to split this flesh wide open and let you find out what's inside of it. I tell you what, man, Jesus hung upon the cross and they split his flesh and the sun was darkened and the earth quaked and the rocks split and the graves opened and people that were dead walked around. What do you think was in that flesh, man? There was glory. You broke that flesh and all kinds of things happened because the glory was inside of him. It was inside of him. It wasn't outside of him. It was inside of him. And that's why Jesus practically talked to them. He said, you take me to the cross. You take my life. He says, you must rip my flesh. You rip my flesh. And you get all of heavenly rings. You get a relish. Rip it. And he says, I'm going to rip yours. From the way you think to the way you live. And I'm going to let you see that the Father's house is not outside you. It's inside you. This life that you live is no ordinary life. You live the life of God upon this planet. Act like it. Act like it. Live like it. Save like it. Love like it. Be like it. Amen.
Amen.
Sometimes in our ignorance, we all want to die. I don't want to die. You don't need to die. We got to rip your flesh. We got to change the way you think. That's all. That's ripping your flesh. I got to change the way you think. Got to change the way you live. All of a sudden, you'll enter the Father's house. Amen?
Amen.
In my Father's house, man, there were many mansions. If it wasn't I saw, I would have told you. Hebrews 10. 19-21. And Hebrews 10 talks about Jesus being upon that cross. And in verse 19, let me read it to you. Verse 19, it says, therefore, brethren, having boldness to enter into the holiest place. Where's the holiest place? The holiest place is beyond the veil. How do you get beyond the veil? You got to rip the veil. It happened at Calvary. His body was rent, and so was the temple rent. The Holy of Holies is inside of you. It's beyond the veil. It's inside of you. You all with me?
Yeah.
The Holy of Holies is beyond the veil. It's inside of you. The place that no one has access to. No one has access to it. There's a God inside of you sometimes that nobody has access to. Can I get a witness?
Amen.
There's a love inside of you sometimes that nobody has access to. There's a kindness inside of you. It's going to take a lot of dynamite to get it out. But it's in you. There's all heaven inside of you. We just don't have access. I can't get to it. Why? Because there's a veil in front of your flesh. I can't get to it. The way you think and believe and the way you live. He said, I'm going to tear that. I'm going to tear it and get into the good stuff. The Holy of Holies. Where is the Holy of Holies? Inside of you. It's where the Father lives. There's nothing more holy and more precious. There is no holy ground more holy than you. Does anybody want to dare to give me a witness on that?
Amen.
Holy ground is you. Because God lives inside of you. How dare you treat your life as anything less? How dare you think your life is anything less? God lives in you. Wow. Wow. We think and we talk as if he doesn't live inside of us. We complain and cry and tear down everything because we don't even know. We don't know. That's why he went to the cross. He went to the cross to give you what was yours all along. You were born with it. He created you with it. He's your creator. When he created you, you had all of his glory because he loves you. Just covered by the veil of flesh, we just got to rip the veil. And that's why Jesus says here, he says he went beyond the veil. What's the veil? The way you think, the way you live is this flesh. Yeah, but he was the forerunner. We had to rip his flesh first. That's as simple as a type. So in verse 19, it says, therefore, brethren, you now have boldness. You can now enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by his sacrifice. He He showed you the way. You now have access into the holy place. You can now live like Jesus lived. You can talk like Jesus talked. You can say, I am the follower of one. You can actually do that. You can actually walk on this earth and say, if you have seen me, you have seen the Father. Not there yet? All right. God's working on you. And there's even a time where Jesus was in front of the unbelievers, believing crowd, and he said to the unbelieving crowd, he says, you have neither seen him nor heard him. But it's only because, man, he was right in front of them. They just didn't acknowledge who he was. So God stood in front of them and said, you have neither seen God nor understand who he is. And meanwhile, it's God in front of them who said that. Because God's right in front of us, but we think he's out there. So it says, now you have boldness to enter in through Jesus. It says in verse 20, by a new and living way. By a new and living way. He is the way. He is the truth. And he is the life. He is the living way. He's going to give you access into the most holy of holies, into the Father's house. It's the Christ that's already inside of you, the hope of glory. Where is your glory? It's just deep inside of you. It's just inside of you. Can I get a witness? Is anybody in the scripture? Christ in you, the hope of glory, it's just inside of you. You got to get to the Father's house. And he said, I'm going to come back and bring you back where I am. Just bringing you inside of yourself. Turning some lights on. Causing the graves to open up and the dead to rise and the saints to walk around. And then you know what happened? It said after the dead people, after they came out of the grave, it said that they started to walk around the city just to be noticed. You know? It's like, they wanted to show themselves off a little bit. Yes. They weren't hiding, but they went to the cities. That's me and you. He's going to wake up that dead one inside of you, and you're going to start showing yourself off, and you're going to say, ta-da, look at me. You're going to go to people and say, hey, I'm happy. Who are you? I'm the resurrected one. Hey, I'm strong. You're going to start showing yourself off. Woo, look at me. Because now you're walking in resurrection life. Folks around you will hardly recognize you. But take joy in it. Go show yourself off a little bit. Go show yourself off a little bit. So in verse 20 here, back in Hebrews again, it says, by a new and living way, it says that he consecrated for us through the veil, that is his flesh. The veil was his flesh. That is broken. And it says, we have a high priest over the house of God. Over the house of God. Who is the house of God? You are the house of God. It said, therefore, let us draw near with a true heart, in full assurance, having faith, and having our hearts sprinkled. Man, we need to have our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure blood. We now have access into the most holy place of all. Where is the most holy place of all? It's inside. It's inside. Where does God live? You don't want to live in no building. He wants to live inside of you. And God's locked up in a box inside of you. It's a gold pretty box, but he's locked up inside of you. We need access to that. It says now we have access into this through who? Through Jesus. When it said that Jesus went through the heavens and he consecrated the true heavens, remember it says he consecrated the true heavens? What are the true heavens? The true heavens aren't up there. You are the true heavens. Jesus said to himself, the kingdom of heaven is inside of you. It's inside of you. Jesus said that, not man. Jesus said, the kingdom of heaven is inside of you. Stop looking here, there, and everywhere. It's among you. It's in you. So when he consecrated, when he died upon the cross, and then he consecrated the true heavens, where do you think he got? He's inside of you. He took the physical body, he turned it into a spiritual body, which is called the Holy Spirit. He entered inside you now with his new being, and he consecrated it. He consecrated the true heavens with blood, and he opened up all the doors in the house. He opened up all the doors and all the windows. Why is it so stuffy in here, he says? He comes into your life, it's a little stuffy in here. And he finally opened up all the doors and windows. Let's open up the heavens and open up the doors and windows. He consecrated it. He says, we got access. You can't get in the room. What's that guy on One Day at a Time? What's his name? Schneider. He gets his keys. Come on, guys. He opens up all the rooms to the house. Your joy is behind this door here. He pulls out his keys. Your peace, oh, come in. It's in this room here. It's inside of you. It's not outside of you. Your love? Oh, man, there's a big room for that one. He says, oh, that door's already open. What do you think the true heavens are? Nothing more precious than you. You're the true heavens. When they go inside you, it's going to open up everything else. It's going to send you out. So go save the world. I save you. Go save the world. The beautiful upon the mountains on the feet of them that bring the news. It's not going to my father's house. I'm going to my father's house. And he said, I'm going to my father's house, he said this. He said, I'm not going to leave you alone, though. I'm not going to leave you without a comforter. He said, I'm going to leave you, but I'm going to send my spirit. He said, I'm going to send my spirit. And scripture says, he says, my spirit is going to be with you and in you. With you and in you. So Jesus had to break that flesh, leave that physical body on the cross of Calvary. He said, Father, into your hands do I commit my spirit. And that spirit of truth, he went inside of you and I and woke up everything that already was there. And then he came and brought you with him into the Father's house. And now all of a sudden, without you sitting this morning, without leaving your seat, all of a sudden, you see the glory of heaven that is all around you, without even moving an inch. And that's why from the beginning of time, from Genesis to Revelation, God goes throughout all of humanity, and we've talked about it before, and he continues to go into your world and my world, and he tells you to look into your world, he tells you to look into your world, and he always says this, he says, what do you see? What do you see? Have you ever heard Jesus say that to one of his prophets or something? He said, what do you see? And this is our life, because all throughout life, we tell God what we see. What do we see? I see this person did that, this person failed there, this person did this wrong, this person is an idiot, this person is blah, 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 I'm sick, I'm weak, I'm tired. Okay. And all through your life, he answers the question, what do you see? What do you see? And he goes through your room, and he opens up the doors, and he says, now what do you see? And little by little, he's in your life saving you, and you start to say, I see God, I see hope, I see love, I see goodness, I see a good father, a good man, a good woman, a good boy, a good girl. What do you see? I don't see evil. I don't see failure. I don't see sin. And at the end of it all, at the end of it all, without John leaving that island of Patmos, at the end of it all, in Revelation, he says, John, what do you see? And the saving of the soul, John finally says, I'm going to tell you what I see. I'm going to tell you what I see. He said, behold. He said, I see a new heaven. And I see a new earth. And I see the Holy City descending from inside of you, not outside of you. He's descending. And the Holy City that's inside of you and all mankind, I see it in you. I see glory in you, and I see glory coming out of you, and it's descending upon the earth. And it says, God says, now my dwelling is with men. Now I live and dwell upon you. And at the end of your salvation, you and I will stop having all these words in our mouth. Off of the wrong tree, we eat off the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. We say, this is good, this is bad, this is good, this is bad. Instead of saying, this is life, this is God, the kingdom of heaven is within. And at the end of it all, we're all going to say, Lord, I look into my world and I see glory. Amen?
Amen.
And so our praise and worship team will come forward. I apologize, I have so many songs with you guys. Let's do Deep in Love, Brother Keith. I'll give you an extra minute. God bless you all. Come on, Robin. Whenever you're ready, you can cue it up. Why don't you all stand with me? Stretch your legs out. During this song, this is what I encourage you to do. I don't even encourage you to sing the words, only you can if you like. But let the word of God that was spoken to you. But why don't you see how God wants to change your life today through his eternal words of truth. Is that okay? Let's take a moment. And then our Pastor Ed was going to come forward and close the voice.